which was held up at the Nanotech Center up in Albany. And I got to tell you, you know, there are always a lot of questions about our youth, about are we staying competitive in this country? Are there new technologies? Are there new ideas? I'll tell you, there are. And we have the winners of the business plan competition this morning sitting down here in the front row who are going to present exactly as they presented up in Albany so we can get an idea, and those of you watching and listening online who are interested in being entrepreneurs or are already entrepreneurs and want to know how to present your business in order to attract funding, to attract coalitions between industry and academics. This is going to be one example of how to do that. So we're very pleased to have them here this morning. I am also pleased to have the got some open source here this morning, and they have tried to explain to me again for about the 99th time on how to make money at open source. And after this presentation, I just might get it. So time will tell. I'm going to ask Jeremy. Jeremy, do we have anybody from Greece on the phone? No. So we're going to pass that off for right now. And if he jumps on, we'll come back to it. I'd like to introduce Brian and the team from Best Technologies. And we're going to ask them to present. I just want to congratulate them. By the way, there was a cash prize awarded, and I'm really kind of ticked because we weren't invited to the party. And I'm sure it was a good one. When the money comes, we have the party. Okay. High on the list. You heard it, right? High on the list. Okay. Brian, come on up. If you want to introduce your team, I'm going to give you the power here. Jeremy, you want to click over to the other presentation, the Best Technologies presentation? We're going to switch mics. Okay.
Testing.
I'm going to move on. Come on up.
Be down here, I believe. I think it might be a little harder for me to be up here. I'll try. So, okay, but good morning. My name is Brian Butcher, and I'm here with Best Technologies. It consists of Isaac Lund, Ben Bax, Fernando Baqueros, and J-Ho Lee, and myself. And Best Technology stands for Battery Energy Storage System Technologies. And this is our presentation that we gave at the Tech Valley Business Plan Competition. Best Technologies. What is our mission? Our mission is to deliver high-efficiency lithium-ion batteries compared to current lithium-ion batteries out on the market. How do we plan to do this? Develop manufacturable silicon anode nanowire technology that is cost-effective and decreases. It's a cost-effective way to increase battery storage life and storage capacity. We do this also by decreasing the battery size, and I'll get into more details in a couple more slides. But our vision can be broken into short, mid, and long-term goals. Short-term, become a prominent battery supplier to the auto EV market. Mid-term, capture 10% of the auto EV market. Long-term, expand to other sectors of the total transportation EV market, and then potentially to other sectors, say portable electronics and other home and commercial applications. The total EV or the total transportation market has the same need for battery performance and efficiency. That can range all the way from locomotives to buses to the full-size battery electric and the hybrid vehicle. We chose to start our company based on the full-size battery electric and the hybrid vehicle. Why? Well, let the numbers do the talking a little bit. By 2015, the lithium-ion EV battery market is projected, this is a study done at MIT, to be $8 billion with a compound annual growth rate of 56%. I apologize, it seemed to be cut off a little bit. This graph, if you look on the left-hand side, this axis is the number of, corresponds to this bar per year, all the way down, and it corresponds to the number of vehicles that are being made every year. The other axis on this side corresponds to this bar, all the way. And that's the number of vehicles in fleet are in the market as we speak. So if you look in 2010, the majority of the cars being made, the majority of cars being made and the number that are already out there on the road are mainly gas-guzzling cars. A couple of hybrids are being made, not that many being driven. But if you notice, by 2020, the hybrid vehicle market is supposed to really pick up. And it's followed by the full-size electric battery vehicle by 2030 to take up most of the market. Oops. Sorry, I'm having a couple technical difficulties. So, by 2030, these are the number of full-size battery electric vehicles that will be being made. This is a number that should be driven on the road. Best Tech is really trying to capture the market of the green and blue here. As you notice, the gas-guzzling cars should go down. So we're trying to position ourselves as a major supplier to the fast-growing EV market. Let's see. Okay, so how do we plan to do this, right? So this is our technology. Our technology is a high surface area silicon nanowire anode. That's what we're focusing right now. Silicon is theoretically optimal storage material for lithium ions. Right now, in the current market, graphite is mainly used for the anode. But the energy storage density for graphite doesn't even compare with silicon. If you look over here, the energy storage density is extremely high compared to the graphite. What does that mean? It means that potentially, in theory, silicon can store a lot more energy than graphite. There's a problem, though. Most anodes that use silicon technology are thin films. And the rigid silicon thin films expand when they absorb all of this lithium, right? Resulting in a lot of stress and pulverization that happens here. The rigid silicon film can expand during charging by over 400%. Silicon films thus stress and detach, resulting in poor energy storage and battery performance. The Best Tech solution is basically, why make them rigid? We can make them out of flexible silicon nanowires. On the nanoscale, silicon or different materials become flexible that were once rigid on the macro scale. We're taking advantage of this by making nanowires and using them to increase the surface area through our proprietary growth method. These are some of our results here that we have. Our anode will consist of an array of nanowires. And the whole point is to have flexible silicon nanowires instead of silicon films to reduce the stress that is seen here so that we can maximize the energy density seen here. This nanowire array also stores lithium content, as I said here, but it also translates into a longer time that you have to travel, or you can travel before you need to recharge your battery, because it can store more density. So Best Tech is aiming to capture the full benefit of the silicon anode performance based on our growth methods here, as compared to what the competitors have. So what is our business model? Our business model can be described with an analogy. Intel is to computers as Best Tech is to smaller efficient batteries. Our niche is to be able to create these smaller, more efficient batteries via proprietary manufacturing. Proprietary manufactured SI nanowire anodes. This enables our customer to do one of two things. They can create a battery of the same size that has a higher efficiency, or we can make a smaller battery that has the same capacity and energy storage that they already have. It gives them options. It gives them a better array of geometry and design that they can do with their battery. Our key strategies for doing this short term is to start with the high profit margin market, such as the EV market, like I explained before. We start with pilot programs, or we're trying to get into the pilot programs with some of these EV manufacturers. And long term, we seek other markets that are high performance demands and have higher growth rates. But right now, that's out of our scope because we're trying to build up our experience with the EV market. First thing we need to look at is our competition, because we do have a lot of competition. Some of these competitors, though, may end up becoming our customers because we're focusing right now on our anode technology, and we could actually sell to them our anode. You notice the lithium battery target markets of each one of these companies. These are the established companies, and these are the startups. If you notice this company right here, that's a pretty big target market. They didn't start that way, though. They started with supplying battery solutions to power tools. We're going to do the same thing, but we're going to supply the anode to the EV market. We're going to start there, and then we're going to expand later. We're going to do the same type of strategy. Start small, and then expand to the big market. We're currently working on a prototype for our anode, and it is being tested against a cathode for the lithium iron phosphate, which is one of the main cathodes that is being used out in the industry today. And to look at our potential customers, this being most of our competition, our potential customers would see this on a chart. So if you notice the battery weight, this kind of brings it home. So the battery weight here normally for the batteries now out on the market, this is our battery weight, right? This is the range, and you can see our range is similar, but we also give like 100% reduction in weight to our batteries. This really shows that our battery can give a lot of different options, or our anode can give a lot of different options for our battery. And we can give the same range with less space, and the manufacturing design freedom is given to our customers because of our anode solutions. So we know that we have a lot to do. The first thing, or milestones, is to get us out of the lab and into the market. Technical milestones, we expand our IP portfolio. We're currently working on protecting our IP and further develop our prototype. Next would be packaging and safety, circuit design, and optimizing our manufacturing process would be next. Scaling up our manufacturing. Our financial milestones, obtain a small SBIR and a federal grant, which will further develop our prototype. We're applying for the CNSC iClean incubator program, and I've actually talked to a couple of you guys as well. Before this started, there's a couple of different incubators that we can look at as well. This is our main option because we are CNSC students. Next, we can hire executives with experience in commercialization to help us get forward after we get our feet off the ground, initial stages. We establish our manufacturing facilities, and our intentions are to go public. However, if we have to have an exit plan, it'll be to be acquired after we go public, if and only if, right? So our financial estimates are based on a 500 battery pilot program that doubles annually. If I can draw your attention here to our seed money, this may seem a little high, but in 2009, the U.S. government made $2.3 billion into the economy based off of the electric vehicle and battery manufacturing initiative. There's going to be a lot more money that's given out because of this. Maybe a little bit less money because of the stimulus, but there will be some. And we figure that this is a conservatively feasible estimate for seed money once we apply our grants. Notice our depth of hole is 3 years, and then we expect to go positive after round 6. This can be explained graphically. If you look, our time to positive cash flow, if you convert this into 2010 dollars, so we know we're not going to start in 2010 because we're actually there in 2000. We're actually here in 2010 now, but by 2011 is when this is actually going to start. But if you take it into 2010 dollars now, in 6 years, we expect to approach somewhere around $6 million. The graph on the right shows that we know that you're potential investors. are looking for their rate of return, and we expect like a minimum of a 15% annual rate of return after we get our initial out of the hole phase. And we really believe that we have an intelligent team, and I apologize for my little bit of stuttering because it's kind of early in the morning, but we have the people is really what matters and what we have in our technology, and those people can be here, written here, starting with myself, and then lead engineers, Isaac Lund and Jae-Ho Lee, who has more degrees than all of us here put together. Our CFO, Robert Himes, and Fernando Gomez Baquero and Ben Bax are our advisors. And we have a lot of engineering support and scientific support from the College of Nanoscale Science and Engineering. And thank you for your attention. That's all I have. And we'll entertain any questions now. Our biggest challenge is to, first off right now, is to build a successful prototype is our first challenge. After that will be harnessing all of the main amount of energy that we can, the most amount of energy we can from the SI anode. The biggest challenge will basically be to manufacture this, right, to get it out into the market, you know.
Well, and to address your concern about the testing and like that, we have basically a full complement of equipment at CNSC where we're, you know, in the iClean facility, we'll have access to all of this equipment. So we will, to put it simply, test the hell out of it right. Before we even, you know, present this to anybody like that. So we know it's going to work.
Well, the Prius battery is more of a hybrid, yeah, too. So it's not a full EV battery, but he knows a little bit more about it.
Yeah, the whoa.
It's kind of throws you off a little bit.
the Prius is a smaller battery because it recharges using a gas engine. It is a hybrid battery, and so it only goes I think 30 miles on the actual battery. On the actual battery power, and then the rest of the time it uses the engine to either charge it or to run the car. So
it doesn't need to be as big, basically what the answer is. But that, well, we're still going in that market too, because we're doing the hybrid and the EV too, so. Yes, we have thought about it. I assume. We have thought about it, and we expect to hit that phase in maybe half a year, a year from now, when we actually get our IP off the ground and we get established in the iClean, which is at CNSC. Because right now our main issue is that we don't want to give any more patents to CNSC than we have to, because we have a lot more ideas. So we're trying to make sure that they just have this one, right? And then we have the ability to stay under the iClean window and develop more of our manufacturing patents that way. And that will be done here up in upstate New York. So,
also to your concern about scalability, this technology is very, it's just based out of semiconductor processing technology, right? And that's one thing that we really know of. And definitely we have a lot of knowledge about that right now at the CNSC, and we've been working with that for almost it's going to be CNC is going to have like 6 years now working on that technology. So it really uses that base technology. We know how to use it, and we know that we can scale it up, and not only scale it up successfully, but quickly, because there's always a knowledge curve that you have to take. But if there's one thing that we're very good at the semiconductor industry, is actually learning pretty fast. So that's going to come to our advantage when we scale up this technology. No, it's actually just very ingenious and very cool semiconductor technology. Yeah.
It's at the end of the day, it's silicon, and we actually CNC.
Yeah.
Once we get the rental rate of their tools settled, we'll be able to use all of their facilities that are very used to silicon, because it's a manufacturing place for the semiconductor industry. So, yes, sir. Like replacement batteries at the charging stations, as opposed to, yeah, the swap. Can you repeat? Like, we thought about it. Yes. Yes, there is. We have looked at it a little bit, but you want to try?
Yeah. There's also. Yeah, I mean, as you say, it's not only Israel. I mean, a lot of different countries are actually investing, you know, a lot of money on battery technologies. And even the U.S. has now a big battery consortium also made out of big automotive companies for GM. So the opportunities out there, you know, we're open to any opportunities. Of course, emerging markets are huge, a huge opportunity. I think that at the stage that we're at right now is we really want to understand the technology and make it better, and you know, and develop this prototype, and it's going to come organically out of that, right? Once you have the great technology, then definitely we're open to working with everybody in the world that actually wants to apply this technology.
Right, exactly. We feel this is a solid business idea because it gives us the ability to supply a certain key component to battery manufacturers on a fundamental level. The anode, the battery doesn't work without it. So as far as building a business plan around that, we feel that it's a really good, solid idea. Is it? We're in it for the long haul, actually. So, good presentation or bad presentation?
I'm wondering how this technology, if you've begun to explore relationships with alternative energy, because the solar business has this natural challenge and hurdle every time the sun goes down. And same thing with wind, when the wind doesn't.
Right, and one of those with the wind power that you just mentioned, one of the key areas that our technology could come in handy is the ability to store that wind energy when the infrastructure is actually there, hooked up to your house, when everybody has these EV cars, to store this wind energy in a more efficient battery inside the cars. Because the main problem with wind storage is that where do you store, or you can't store it, right? You can generate it. So if we can store it in our cars, not our, but our batteries, it would be better. So.
Well, yeah, and to that point as well, we're focusing on the EV, electric vehicle market because of the information that's there. But yeah, definitely one of the longer term solutions that we're looking for will be larger kind of power grade battery solutions for that.
And also those folks. We could move. Our initial plan was to move into the home. Battery storage for homes, but it's not, the infrastructure is not there yet. But we expect different other solutions for alternative energy to come up for our batteries later on. So, yes, sir.
What is the range of
Well, that's it's one of your options. You can either reduce it, or you can keep the same energy, or you can keep the same size. And because our key technology is a high energy, a high surface density, which allows you to store more lithium in the anode. So if you have the same battery with the same size, you can increase the capacity. That's one option. But you're talking about focus on the one where you have the other option to reduce the battery size. Our whole thing is to give our customer options. No, it's about capacity.
It's capacity. Capacity dictates the size that you have, and then also the range that you have. So having a higher capacity material like silicon, it allows you to shrink the size but maintain the same range, or keep the same size and increase the range. So.
I just want to remind the team that, there you go, thank you. The Hudson Valley Center for Innovation down here is an iClean partner, so, you know, and putting iClean in your presentation did get you a lot of brownie points. So. It obviously worked, so good job. Jeremy, do we have guys from Greece on, or yes or no? No, okay, he was on, but he's gone. So I'll bring you to our guest speakers this morning, Kirk and Jeff from Open Source. And we're going to queue up your presentation here in just a moment. Open Source has been, like I said before, a mystery to me. How you make money at Open Source, who should be doing it, why, what is Open Source, and how all of us can be taking advantage of open source technologies. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Kirk Ritchie, and he's going to explain to me exactly how this works. And when you want to advance your slides, you just push the bottom arrow.
Okay.
I think.
Thank you, Les.
And we'll get your presentation up there.
All right. While we're waiting for the presentation to come up, let me just introduce myself. And Jeff Collins, my partner, is here as well. Kirk Ritchie, I'm the president of a startup company, Open Source Business Consulting. And the reason why we started is we felt there was a need to help facilitate and help people understand the benefits of open source, and specifically related to businesses. The experiences that my past experience for the past 17 years has been implementing enterprise solutions for national organizations or global organizations. Enterprise solutions meaning for the manufacturing, for customer relationship management, for any aspect of the enterprise in itself. The ERP solution, basically enterprise solutions. And so coming from that perspective of enterprises, we felt that it was important for startup businesses and existing businesses to understand the value of how open source can better serve your own organization. So today, the agenda we're just going to talk about briefly is that, you know, today's objective is really, again, every business is oriented around its own innovation. And every business has to have, there's a certain element of speed to market. And then every business has cost controls that they have to adhere to in order to maintain a level of profitability. And once that, for startups, the innovation is there, but innovation is a lifeblood of an organization, even once it's established. So there's an aspect of agility that's necessary as well. So rigid systems are oftentimes they prevent innovation. And I've seen this myself in the IT systems that organizations put in, that they're not able to adjust to the demands of the marketplace. And so there's a need for agility, and it's a very important aspect of a business. So today what we're going to do is answer the question, what is open source? A lot of people have an idea of what open source is. We'll go into that. Why should we use open source? What is the advantages of using open source? And again, this is all oriented around businesses, okay? I'm not really talking about personal solutions for your home or for things of that nature, but I'm talking more from an enterprise perspective. And then also, who's using open source? What are the institutions that are out there? What are the organizations out there that are using open source? And then vendor strategies. I think this is an important aspect of it, because if any of you decide or any of us decide to engage in a vendor, it's important to understand where they're coming from as well. Okay, so we'll go into that a little bit. And then adoption strategy for open source and some of the things you would want to consider. And then finally, some of the leading and emerging open source solutions that are in the marketplace today. So let's get started here. So from the Wikipedia, everybody likes to refer to the Wikipedia. A definition of open source is essentially this. It's where typically the source code has been held by the company who's the copyright holders. In this case, open source is provided to the user under a license agreement or placed in the public domain. Many of us are aware of open source from a perspective of the public domain, where you can go out and you can download the software, and then you use it, okay? And it's usually pretty straightforward. There is a license agreement for organizations from an enterprise perspective, okay? So oftentimes it's referred to as commercial open source. Okay, so it is still, you're still given the source code, and that's an important aspect of it. Being given the source code of a software is something that's important to you, because you will be able to then to adjust that software to customize it to fit your specific needs, and that's an important aspect for any business. Instead of having locked in to the vendor, where the vendor itself is controlling your capabilities of using that software. Some people believe that there should be a governing institute that it creates a standard, much like you find in like organic, in the natural foods, how some people will put the word organic on, and if there's not an institution there that can verify that it is actually organic. So there's a lot of people that believe that there should be an institute of standards, and there is, and there are institutes of standards within the open source industry. And that's something that's important as well, because all the solutions that are provided need to have a certain set of standards. We're living in an environment where our systems will need to interface with others very easily and very quickly. So those standards are a critical part of us being able to have that interface be able to exist efficiently. So again, you may not find that every single open source company adheres to an industry standard, but the majority of them actually do. As far as the evolution of the technology stack, the way it's really began is it started in the infrastructure, open source. It started with Linux. And actually open source has been, there's some of the projects, the web started with a collaborative environment, and there was more of an open environment. And then out of that came what we know as today as the World Wide Web. So it's been around for a number of decades. The idea of collaboration, the idea of having an open system. But the Linux operating system is really the first one that really took seed and really grew to a point where it had massive acceptance. And then from that came the application, or the appliance, if you will, the servers. And that's where Apache and Red Hat stepped in and started developing servers for the operating system to function on. And then you had database management systems such as MySQL and Postgres and Ingress are both actually, they're 20 plus year old open source communities, and they started in the same community and then split up into two separate aspects of database management systems. MySQL now is owned by Oracle, and we'll get into that a little bit later. And then, of course, the languages, those two. So all of this, what you see here, is all the infrastructure of a system. So you're talking about the operating system, the server, and the language that's creating the software. And the next wave of things is, then the next wave where there were individual applications, okay? And, the browser. Netscape was built on the premise of open source. And then Firefox, Mozilla, is actually... you know, does anybody use Microsoft Firefox? So again, you're using an open source solution, you know, so it's a very common, it's a very easy, you know, very commonly found. Hotmail was the first free email. That was not open source, but then Gmail is also not open source, but some of the systems within Gmail is open source. And so and then of course word processing, you have Open Office that you can download and use that, and it's very compatible to that compared to Microsoft Word Office. To continue that evolution, we now have enterprise solutions, enterprise applications. Full ERP solutions, enterprise resource planning solutions, which for those of you who aren't aware what that is, that's a full suite of applications that will run a business, meaning your financial management system, if you're manufacturing, you'll have a shop floor manufacturing capability, your materials planning processes, the MRP, materials resource planning, your production scheduling capability, your warehouse management, usually that's a bolt-on, and then other things related to manufacturing and supply chain management as well, some in there. And that's a full suite of ERP solutions. Oracle offers that. You've heard of SAP. That's an ERP solution provider. And Microsoft has a few solutions that they've purchased that they offer that are under a different name. So in the open source world, there are ERP solutions. Okay, and then CRM, customer relationship management. Many people may be aware what that is. What is the most common? You know, it's Salesforce.com, right? And that's a SaaS model. And we'll speak about them in a moment. But there are open source solutions that are pure open source, and you know, Sugar CRM and vTiger CRM. E-commerce is the solutions or software that people use to manage their web and commerce on the web. So that's a solution. Magento is a very, very good solution, and it's an open source solution. Business intelligence, which happens to do with analytics and business analytics, and allows you to understand the intricacies of your customers or of your suppliers or of your product demand. And of your own internal aspects of your business. Jaspersoft is actually the largest business intelligence company in the world, and they're an open source company. Pentaho is a startup company that is up and coming and a lot of people are paying attention to. Enterprise integration is an important aspect, and there's a company that started in 5 years ago in France by the name of Talent. So these are open source solutions, and we'll talk more about what those are. Now, people have probably heard of cloud computing, and cloud computing is essentially software as a service. You've heard of that, SaaS, right? Where you have platform as a service, infrastructure as a service. So that's what cloud computing is. And Eucalyptus is actually an acronym. I'm not going to tell you what the acronym is because I can't remember what it is. But you can create your own cloud, and it's an open source solution for that. So this is to continue to acknowledge the evolution of open source and how it's evolving into all of the aspects of typical what you would expect to find. The distribution models of open source and why, you know, use open source. Well, for small companies, for startup companies, and for the mid-market, enterprise solutions are really expensive. They're really very difficult to procure. And so the capital expenditure rate, the initial capital expenditure is very, very high. In open source, that's been basically drastically reduced. So now you have an opportunity to introduce the opportunity to have tools for the small business and medium-sized businesses because you have a much lower capital expenditure to invest in the solutions. So that's one really great advantage of it. The risk mitigation that's there. Many of the solutions you're able to download and then test them and use them. In software proprietary, you try to get the software from the proprietary user, you know, from Oracle, and have them use it. That'll be difficult. You know, so you have the ability to test it within your own domain, with your own people, and with your own data. And so that, again, mitigates the risk for you. Access to the source code, again, no vendor lock-in, allows you to customize the application and tweak it to fit specifically what may be necessary for, in order for you to do that. Instead of having to say, okay, we can use 70% of the solution and we have to create 30% workarounds or some other aspect. Some people jokingly say that the ERP solution of the world is an Excel spreadsheet. And that's really, in many cases, true, you know, because you can't quite do everything in the solution, what is known as the enterprise solution. So what do? You export it, you put it into Excel spreadsheet, and then you talk to someone, you have a meeting about it, and you share the Excel spreadsheet. So that's what I mean by customization. That's exactly what I mean by customization. Now, why is it that you can, that you know, that you have an enterprise you're trying to run efficiently, and here you have to export out of that solution and then and put it into an Excel spreadsheet and talk about it. So you lose efficiencies there. You lose automation capabilities. Access to the code is actually very critical. The developer and user community. In an open source environment, the developers and the users are in the same room. That's really important, because in a proprietary environment, the developers are in headquarters or wherever they are, and they're developing for you, the user. And so in the open source community, the users are in speaking with the developers. They're communicating with the developers. So the solutions are oftentimes very user friendly, and the adoptions and the quickness of improvements are often very user oriented. So it's highly competitive when it comes to the actual solution, because again, it's the functionality is towards the user. So the solutions are oftentimes greatly approved over some of the proprietary, more commonly known solutions that we are used to hearing about. There's multiple ways of engaging in those communities: forums, wikis, blogs. There's training. There's web training through the web, or there's on-site training, and of course user conferences. So the user community is a very important aspect of an open source environment. And then the support and maintenance. It's typically traditional. Again, I'm referring to the enterprise solutions in this case. Throughout this whole presentation, I'm always talking about the business applications and the business solutions. The support and maintenance is very traditional. It's very standard to what you would expect in an environment where what you would expect as a business user. So, but they're far less in cost. Again, much less. So, that's another capital expenditure that's to our benefit. So to continue, just to summarize why we would want to use, is that we have, lowers our operational cost. And that's a critical aspect of running a business. You have lower on your initial cost of license procurement. You have lower support and training cost. And then you have a less risk, and you as far as determining upfront, no real upfront risk in terms of investment. The innovation, the rapid time to market, and the issues related to it, going back to the community and how quickly you're able to influence it. If something is lacking in the solution that you're using, you're able to go back to that development community, and I think you would be surprised to see how quickly there could be something that could be developed that would be to your favor. So again, fast improvements and upgrades are the main reasons. So those are the two, I think, very compelling reasons why companies should consider open source. And it can coexist with proprietary systems. There's no need for, so coexistence is something that's necessary. Much of our business systems are very disparate and, have multiple systems, multiple databases, and so, coexisting is something that we would expect. Who's using it? I think the growth of the technology, we're only around like 10 years, a little over 12 years in terms of since Linux really took seed and started happening. So I don't know why this isn't working. Which way should I be pointing? Whichever way it works. Okay. All right, there we go. All right, so this is a It used to be that downloads were a measure of open source, because that's how you obtained them, right? So in 2000, you have 12,000 downloads, okay? In 2008, you had 1 billion. So it's huge, huge. Now, when it comes to open source is considered, each solution is considered a project, okay? So a project would be like OpenOffice. That's a project, okay? Or a project management solution in open source, that would be a single project, okay? And there are some projects that are called super projects, like Talon, the integration suite, is a super project, or an ERP solution would be a super project, okay? There are 19,000 projects right now, 19,000 last year. So that's a tremendous amount of projects, okay? And many of those are super projects, okay? Such as MySQL or something of that nature. So there's a lot of innovation going on in the software world that to be aware of that would be to our advantage. That some of the companies that are using open source strategies, the federal government, NSA, NASA. NASA is a big, big user of open source, okay? The Department of Defense, DOD. So all of these institutions, the federal government, one thing they're doing is moving off of Oracle and going to a Postgres environment because it's 1/6 the cost. 1/6. Same functionality, same capabilities, and 1/6 the cost. So doesn't take much to figure that one out. Web 2.0 companies, we're familiar with that term, I think. Google, Facebook, YouTube. Missoula isn't really a company, it's a foundation, but they're the people they're the foundation and the community that's behind Firefox. So these are companies that they're not necessarily open source themselves, but the foundation of their organization is built on open source. I'll give you an example. They have, Google runs a lot of their systems, they rely a lot on open systems. They have 10 million servers globally. Estimate, nobody really knows, So an estimate of 10 million servers. Now if they had to spend $1,000 on a software to put on the servers, that'd be $10 billion. So they save $10 billion by using open source. That's substantial. And that's one of the reasons why I'm talking to you today, because those are the kinds of savings that you should be thinking about in terms of your own business scaling, your own, the capacities that you're trying to think about. Open source can provide you a tremendous amount of savings by thinking about it from a strategic perspective. SaaS companies, Salesforce.com, is again a company that their operations, the day-to-day operations, they're using open source. Public companies, IBM, Virgin Air. IBM, one of the things I like about IBM is that they are strategic thinkers, and they're always strategically positioning themselves in markets. They're one of the best strategic thinking companies in the world. They started looking at open source in 2001, individually. It got to the strategic level in 2003. And in 2008, they made over $1 billion from open source. In 2005, I believe, they made a decision to make all of their applications and solutions available on Linux and Apache. And then they created a very strong relationship with Linux community and got involved with the Linux community in a very, very big way. And so from there, it just exploded into dealing with Red Hat and Apache and everything of that nature. Virgin Air, interesting enough, has anybody flown on Virgin America? Around here? Yeah, nice airlines, huh? Every single application running that airlines is open source, except for three. Three? The one. The screen that's in front of you, that is a proprietary system, because they couldn't get it in open source. But the entire company is run. ERP systems, the maintenance systems, the marketing and customer relationship management, all of it is open source. Every aspect of the business. And that's Virgin Air. So that's a good example of how prominent open source solutions are available to businesses today. All right, this is the evolution, and this is something I want you to make, I wanted to be the evolution of it. This is kind of like where somebody started, they built something and said, oh, you know, try this. They give it to their friends and then, you know, try it. And then it grew into that the vendors began to get involved with some of the developers and started to, help those developers to package that solution and create more of an offering into the marketplace, okay? And then, you know, this is where a good example of stage two would be Red Hat, got involved with Linux, okay? And then they packaged Linux in a way where it was made available on servers. And then you had a stage where vendor dominant, they started dominating the solutions. So now you have a whole realm of companies that are open source, they're VC backed, and they're basically moving into the community of open source, and they're dominating that community and they're moving it into the marketplace, for the benefit of the market and themselves. And this is basically where we are now, is you have vendor dominant in terms of the development. So now you've got, you're using open source as a concept for developing a solution. So you're developing the community, you're encouraging the community, but it's all, again, driven from a VC-backed or a vendor that is oriented around developing that solution, but they're using open source as a means, as a business strategy, to develop the solution. Some of the things that's, we don't know where it's going to go, but there's definitely the evolution of the market, if you will, in open source is something that there's going to be a lot more that will come. Cloud computing is a lot that is influencing things in that nature. The CEO of MySQL, who grew the company and MySQL is a database management system famous for being used by the Web 2.0 companies, mainly because it's a very, very good transactional database for in terms of web and what's needed on the web. The CEO of MySQL, eventually they were bought by Sun, okay, and then Sun bought Microsystems. Well. Oracle bought Sun Microsystems. So he left. And he is now the CEO of Eucalyptus. So pay attention to that. Cloud computing. So that was the company it was the open source cloud computing company. So pay attention to that company. This slide is up here to show the sophistication of open source. When a software vendor is thinking about a business strategy, this is the area. I was at a conference in the last month or maybe the month before. I was at a conference and this slide was up for over an hour, and we talked about this slide in all the different ways. So essentially, what a vendor thinks about, this is what they think about when they think about open source, and when it comes to developing. Defining the community, they'll look at, well, how can we develop, should the development be public or private, or a vendor, there's different, all the different slices and ways of developing the community itself, and then how are they going to license the community within that community, license give permission for that community to use that. And then when it comes to I think the battery in this thing is really there. We go. So when it comes to customer relationships, these are all the revenue aspects that they will consider, and each company, each vendor, varies in how they will approach. And in the core of this is the IP. Is the IP of that particular solution. So this is up here only to give you a sense of the complexity, and that every time you speak to an open source vendor. Be aware of this, because it varies from, like Linux uses a foundation to control their IP. Someone else, the vendor itself, will control the IP, okay? So there's different priorities that are out there, and that you as a user, as a buyer, should be aware of that and understand what you're stepping into. And this is really the reason why I wanted to bring these slides to us. But again, you could, every single company, MySQL has a different model than Eucalyptus. And Talon has a different model than MySQL. So it just, it varies greatly from company to company. Again, emerging or leading, I've already mentioned some of these. These are ERP solutions, Bravo and Compeer, CRM solutions is Sugar CRM and vTiger. Business intelligence is Jaspersoft, enterprise integration, Talon, and database integration, database management system. You have Enterprise DB. What they've done is they've basically seven of the top 10 community leaders of the Postgres community now work for Enterprise, and they created five more minutes. Okay, I'm almost done. They created scripts and capabilities to migrate off of Oracle and SQL and DB2, and you know, just again, going back to that total cost of ownership issue. So cloud computing. Now, an adoption strategy. You know, I'm going to the adoption strategy, as far as I'm concerned, is something that should be considered. And I'm putting all of this up here because I would prefer to think about it from the bottom up, the way the slide is designed, not from the top down. But most people, you know, want to evaluate and educate yourself. There are many, many ways to do that, starting back at the top. You know, using, you know, there are white papers available about the solution. There are webinars. There are forums. You can download the version, and usually you have either a time limit or a version limit that you can use, but you can still use the solution to test it. You can arrange for a demo. You have to look at the difference between whether you join the community, which is oftentimes free, may often be a limited version of what you would need, or whether you would invest in the commercial use of it, and then identify the key technical people within your organization and have them align with the community and get involved with the community and become then they become a great resource within your enterprise in relationship to that particular solution. Start with non-mission critical solutions, non-mission critical issues, maybe a subset database instead of a mission critical database. You know, those kinds of projects. Start from the outside, work in terms of using open source. You know, and then evaluate it. You know, what are your key deliverables, and within that, what's the ROI, and then use that as a way of moving forward and evaluating whether you how to continue. But most importantly, create a strategy. Look at it from a top down perspective, and create an open source strategy that is in line with your overall IT strategy and your business strategy. So just real quickly, who we are. We are open source business consulting. We're here to help companies understand the strategic positioning and the value of open source. We also have expertise within certain domains of what we consider to be leaders within the open source environment, open source market. So our role or our purpose is to help companies leverage the benefits of open source for their own enterprises by providing planning and plan execution strategies and by integration. The ERP is still a very difficult a suite to implement and requires some expertise to implement it, and also integration. If it's a solution that just needs to be integrated within your system, that's something we will provide as well. Open source support and maintenance. We are the you know, first person to call, or tier one level of support and maintenance as far as training and upgrades, and then finally, hosting and solutioning of or cloud computing for the solution itself. You know, what we are, you know, our people, as far as we have experience in enterprise solutions, years of it, and we're committed to using open source solutions, so open source products. And then finally, our clients, the two primary focuses that we feel like we deliver is lowering the total cost of ownership of your IT enterprise and providing increases in your operational efficiencies. So I thank you for your attention and your time. And if anybody has any questions, Les is pacing here, but I'd be happy, and Jeff and I would be happy to take any questions either now or afterwards, whatever you prefer. Sure. Yep. I'll be around. Pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff. Sure. Going to do it after. We're going to try and get John from Athens, Greece here on the line. He's been holding on now for about 20 minutes, and let's see if we can do that. Just hang in there. Technology is a wonderful thing when it works. I could sing. No. There we go. Good morning, John.
Good morning. Greetings from Greece. Good morning.
How are you? Sorry for the delay.
No, not a problem at all. Not a problem. It was a very interesting presentation.
So, you know, we've been doing this for the past couple of months because, number one, Andreas is a good friend, and it's been very interesting to see what's been happening in Greece and how it's been affecting us here in the United States in the financial markets and entrepreneurs worldwide looking for capital, looking for expertise. From your standpoint, John, how has it affected a lot of what's going on in Greece right now?
Well, in general, things are very difficult here in Greece. I mean, since we're in the middle of the economic crisis and the economy has taken a serious downturn, but it's making things very difficult for companies, but we are very happy for the opportunity that this could become a crisis, could become an opportunity for everybody. And there is some part of the population, entrepreneurs, that are believing that. Greece has a long-term tradition in, like, corruption in the government and a lot of bureaucracy. So we're hoping that this will be an opportunity for the government to change a lot of these things that were wrong in the past. And hopefully they're up to it. So that's actually the big bet now. Everybody's really patient as to see the performance of the government. Luckily, our prime minister is a very enlightened individual. He's broad-minded. But there are a lot of worries about the government team. So to see if they're up to par as to making this transition into the new economy that we're all hoping that's going to come around. So things are still difficult. Some people are over the shock. People are starting to make their plans in order to survive this crisis and this really bad economic downturn. Liquidity is low in the market. But let's see, we're all hoping that this is a good opportunity, and things will be definitely a lot more clearer in the fall, when we, in the month of October, when we have to pass the final exams for the IMF.
Here in the United States, it's over the last year or two or three, there's been a change in kind of the makeup of the entrepreneurial community, where older people, no jokes here, older people are more interested in becoming entrepreneurs. Is that trend the same in Greece and the EU?
Well, I can't really talk for the rest of the EU, even though I believe that Greece is a very, very different country from the EU. So probably that is true in England and Germany, where entrepreneurship is something that is common. In Greece, it wasn't like that up to now, and I believe that the older people, in general in age, are tired. And they really don't wish to be that innovative. They have a specific mindset. So it's a shame to say, but I really believe that that's a generation that really has nothing to offer as far as innovation and entrepreneurship. Of course, their experience is desired by everybody, but as far as innovation, no. What I'm happy to speak about is that I see that a lot of young people who usually would be looking for a secure job are really turning to entrepreneurship. And a lot of innovative ideas, you know, Andreas is very keen on innovation and finding people with innovative ideas. A lot of people have come forward to Andreas and me to present innovative ideas. So entrepreneurship, for young entrepreneurship, is something that I believe is going to become a big trend in Greece. And that's one thing that actually is making me very happy, that to see that out of this crisis, that's a big opportunity that hopefully Greece will be able to take advantage of.
Interesting. I'm going to ask our audience, does anybody have any questions or things they'd like to know about what's going on over there, and ask John? Nobody. Somebody make up a question. Brian, ask him a question, would you?
You're an entrepreneur. I do have a question, but it's not so much related to Greece, but to the EU. I know that Les talked about most young entrepreneurs, or the rate of entrepreneurs in the United States has taken a decline, but it usually in the past has been relatively high. And I know that compared to the EU, they may produce higher quality entrepreneurs, but I know that it's not as easy to be an entrepreneur in Europe as it is the United States because of different legality issues. Is that true?
Well, yeah,
mainly
it,
England.
It is true.
I guess.
Basically, this is like a cultural difference. In Greece, up to now, since I can speak for Greece very clearly in regard to the U.S., they cultivate this culture from a very young age. You know, a lot of people in the United States are supposed to get a job very young in order to start thinking about business-like and in general becoming entrepreneurially oriented, let's say. In Greece, it's not like that. Basically, up to a few years ago, entrepreneurs were not really, let's say, the best part of society. People looked at them in a very, very strange way. That was basically because of the political part and the government, which in Greece is basically the thing that's holding the whole Greek economy down. It's basically the government. The public sector is always vibrant, always alive, always trying to move ahead, is in fact very, very much ahead of the government as far as international relations, as far as looking abroad, as far as opening new markets. But now it's the government's turn. So we're hoping that the government is going to take a specific look at this and change so that entrepreneurship can be more cultivated, because basically that's the only solution right now. And although I believe that the government realizes that, it's very, very difficult to change the mindset of the country in such a small amount of time. We saw the reactions in the demonstrations. It was a huge shock to the Greek people that their lives up till now were based on money that were loans. So this is a communal shock. This is a shock that's going through the community. So it has to be taken in very small steps, but hopefully at the end of the day, it'll be taken in stride, and we'll have the results that we all want.
And just a follow-up question, is it? I would think that one of the reasons why it's that much easier in the United States to be an entrepreneur, take Silicon Valley, for example, it's okay to fail, you know, and they kind of take their failed companies in the past and use them as award badges to start their new company.
Definitely.
And in the in Europe, it's not the same, and that could be tied to what you're talking
about.
I can
totally agree with that. In Greece, actually, you're punished if you fail. You're kind of blacklisted, and that's pretty sad, actually. Things have been very, of course, with the bankruptcy law that came about. Now they tried to change that, you know, from very severe measures to trying to make it a little more better for somebody to try to restart again. But we're very, very far off from the result or anything like in the United States, where people consider that failing is just okay. You just pick yourself up again and you keep going. Of course, if you have the financial resources. Another problem in Greece, of course, is that it's not only the failure; it's actually that. It's very difficult to find the people to help you here in Greece, financial institutions, specialists, consultancies. So these are all very, very needed in the Greek market, but at the moment there are very, very few people that can supply these services. So in the end, I'd like to say that I think Greece is a very interesting market, as a matter of fact, and I believe that people should be looking at the Greek market, because as an economy takes a downturn, of course, it's going to take an upturn. We're all hoping, of course. And this should be cleared up by September or October. So anybody who's looking towards some type of cooperation or foreign investment, which Greece is actually giving a lot of things forward so that they can get some foreign investment, I think that they'll be in a very, very good position to take advantage of the economic upturn, which we are all hoping, of course, will be coming up. And, of course, the entry into the Balkan markets, South, East Europe, which, of course, Greece is in the best position for somebody to take advantage of all that market. So it's something interesting. Let's hope for the best. Right now, we just have to have some patience and see what we can do best just to get by.
John, we have one more question.
Of course.
Yasu, John, this is Dave. How are you?
Hi, Dave, yes.
My question is based on entrepreneurship and what we have going here in Kingston, New York, where we're talking to you from, on a street level movement is tech clusters, entrepreneurial get-togethers, and what we call our digital corridor. This is based on a lot of entrepreneurs and single business owners getting together to advance ideas, business ideas, promotions, and a lot of it is based on personal interaction and also Wi-Fi connections. How prevalent is that in Athens or the surrounding areas?
Well, to tell you the truth, it's not very common. What I'm happy to say, though, is that in the past few months, we've seen a lot of these interactions, these networking events coming together from various areas where you would never ever have seen that before. Universities, private sector, private businesses, of course, Andreas and me as a company, and of course, our organization of young entrepreneurs are trying to put things like that together. But in general, you're hearing things coming from the left and the right where people are organizing these things. And that's very, very good news. Of course, I'm not sure that yet this is going to give the result that we all want, but of course you have to make your baby steps before you make the large steps. So I think that those are very in a good direction, and I think that they're going to help Greece in general. I would like to see them more strategically placed. I mean, like somebody overlooking all this so that the result is funneled into one area and that we get the most efficiency out of these. But at the moment, I'm happy that these are happening out of places where you would never have seen this before in previous years. So it's something that's coming up. Entrepreneurs are getting together because they've been beaten up pretty bad. Young entrepreneurs are looking to find knowledge and finance. So everybody's like kind of huddling together in the storm. That's what I see. And that's what's happening right now with these events. So it's kind of happening, not as much as we'd like to, but it's happening, and it's happening more and more. So that's something that's very positive.
John, thank you. We have one more question.
Of course.
John, is there a mechanism to peacefully remove the tight grip that unions have on the Grecian economy?
Okay, I think that there has to be kind of a discussion as to what is reality and what is politics. In politics, okay, they have a type of tight grip. They're able to strike, which means they're able to actually call on a strike. It doesn't mean that there's huge participation in these strikes. A lot of these unions are old dinosaurs that people really aren't interested in anymore, and they realize that, you know, there's a discussion about the crisis of these unions and stuff like that. So there's one part that, you know, the unions kind of believe that they have this power, but they actually don't have this power. A lot of things are interaction among people. It's just that, when a business starts, employees kind of have this fear. You know, they've heard these old stories where, you know, like the employees or employers are, or entrepreneurs are not going to give them the money, they're not going to share their profits, they're not going to take care of them. So they kind of, you know, take all these old stories from their parents and from their grandparents and stuff like that. But they see that things are different. You know, my generation and the one before us that are working 20-year-olds, they don't see that. You know, they don't see that there's like a slave labor and all these politicians, what they're talking about is actually happening. So, you know, that's where they get this diffusion. They don't really see the credibility in the union. So I think with this crisis, a lot of things are going to be formally overturned. But I think in the real market, they've already been overturned. So I don't really think that somebody has to take a serious look at these unions when they're making an investment here at all.
I should tell you that John started life as a New Yorker. Is that correct?
Yeah, I was born in Astoria, 1967, New York. And I came to Greece with my parents in 1990.
Great. Any other questions for John? John, thank you so much. Thank you for being patient with us this morning.
And
I know Andreas is coming here. He'll be here in July. And for those of you that don't know, we are trying to strengthen the relationship between the young entrepreneurs of Greece and the EU with the Hudson Valley Center for Innovation, with iClean, and with doing cross-pollination of businesses back and forth. We had a presentation last month from a company, and we are expecting their business plan shortly. We have one group that's interested in furthering that relationship. So that's the purpose of all this. It's not just business, it's culture, it's friendship, it's understanding, and to give us a global perspective of the entrepreneurial markets worldwide. So, John, thank you very much, and have a good evening.
Thank you. Thank you, Les. Good morning to everybody, and thank you for the opportunity to participate.
Thank you so much. Well, I just wanted to do a couple things. I wanted to thank Hudson Catskill Catering. Catskill Catering provides our breakfast. As always, they did a great job. We have a wonderful speaker lined up for next month. I'm not going to keep keep you. I will keep you guessing and not tell you who it is now. He's in the room, but I'm not going to tell you. And it'll be a very interesting topic, one that I know will be of interest to every entrepreneur looking for funding and how to go about it. We have lots going on. The iClean relationship with University of Albany Nanotech and with NYSERDA is proceeding full speed ahead. There's a lot of activities. We'll try and keep you abreast. Thank you, Clayton, from coming down from Albany from NYSTAR this morning. We appreciate it. To all, have a very productive week. Thank you all for coming. Mingle and network and ask Kirk and Jeff questions.